Today I want to try something a little bit different. I want to talk to you about something that's been really heavy on my heart and in my mind, and something that means a lot to me. So for the past 4 or 5 years, I've been studying grief in myself and across cultures, and my new series that I'm working on is based on grief, grieving rituals, death rituals, stuff like that. And something that I've tried to practice in my life is to choose grief. And I almost debated saying that because it sounds like a really crazy thing to do, but I want to talk about the benefits of that and how that relates to art and how that relates to life in general. Just choosing grief. What if you choose areas of difficulty in your life to pursue? And I guess another word is discomfort, because I think that a lot of times grief and discomfort go hand in hand, whether, you know, whichever one comes first, it changes, of course, and it can change the experience, whether discomfort comes first and then you grieve, or grief comes first and then you experience discomfort. But that's been really present in my life and really prevalent for 2020 and probably for a lot of people, given the state of the world right now. So I wanted to touch on this. How do we choose grief, and why is that a benefit in our lives and in our art? So my story kind of starts, like I said, about 5 years ago, when I went through a cycle of grief that I couldn't really get out of. And I'm not going to talk about what triggered that or exactly what that was out of respect of the situation, but I went through a cycle of grief that I just couldn't get out of. I just kept repeating it over and over for about 2 years. And I didn't know what it was exactly. I hadn't really experienced grief in my adult life up until that point. I had experienced it as a kid, as a teenager, but not in my adult life. And so it was really weird for me, and I didn't know what to do with that feeling, as so many of us experience, as everyone will experience the first time you go through grief as an adult, which is that you're kind of trapped in a cycle that you don't recognize as grief, most likely. It's something that is not easily defined or quantifiable. It's something that can happen on purpose or by accident. There are circumstances out of our control. So I started to experience grief in just a really weird way, where I didn't know it was happening, and I didn't understand why I felt the way that I did, and I didn't understand why I couldn't handle it, whatever that means, to handle grief. So that was 5 years ago, and fast forward to this year, I became a foster parent, and I knew this was coming, which is a whole other part of the story of my grief, which maybe I'll talk about sometime, but I finally came to the decision to become a foster parent, and I spent one full year preparing, and the whole year didn't know if it would really happen due to several different circumstances, and spent that year grieving because I didn't know if it would happen. I had already had to come to terms with what it would mean to be a mother, what it would mean in my world, where I always thought it would be traditional, or at least more traditional than what it is. And so finally in December last year, I got placed with my first child, and he's a 2-year-old little boy, and I can't tell you much more than that. And he's with us right now, but won't be much longer. And we're about to lose him to really unfortunate circumstances that I never saw coming. I just didn't even know it was a possibility. So I'm going through another cycle of grief, because for the past 7.5 months, I have had this little boy in my house, and I have loved him, and I have been so angry with him and everything that probably any normal mother feels, and I've come to terms with what that means. I decided to talk about this today because I got a message online the other day that basically just said, you chose foster care, so there's no reason why you should be upset about it. And I was thinking about how we love to take control of other people's grief and emotions of any kind, and to put our stamp on them and say, you deserve this, or you don't deserve this, or my experience doesn't match up to yours, or your choices are your own, so you shouldn't feel a certain way. And this is something that we do all the time. Humanity does this all the time. We try to inject ourselves and our opinions into other people's emotions, which I think is largely unhealthy, but I want to talk about how that influences our decisions, our lives, our art, etc. So I kind of took this comment in, and part of me didn't disagree with that person in saying that I don't deserve to feel bad because I chose this. But then I started thinking about how if we only chose to do things that we felt apathetic about or that we didn't feel strongly about, then we wouldn't have much of a life to speak of, would we? So much of my life has been spent, at least my adult life, has been spent choosing difficulty, choosing grief, because in doing that, you also choose joy. And you choose all those amazing emotions that counteract the grief. And this really started for me in my photography. And even really before that, in high school, I took up filmmaking or videography or whatever you want to call it. And I was choosing something that I didn't know would be difficult. When I chose to go to film school, I chose a more difficult path. I chose something that would be highly unlikely to make me money, as everyone told me 1,000 times. Something that was expensive to get a degree in, expensive to do and make. I ended up moving across the country for that career to Los Angeles, where I had no idea how that would turn out. And then finally, after all of that, I started photography, which doesn't seem like such a leap to make at that point, right? It's like, photography is less expensive than filmmaking. It's more accessible, but nonetheless really unpredictable. And when I started my career in photography, everybody said, oh, you shouldn't rely on that. It's really hard to make a living, especially doing the weird stuff that I was doing. But I decided to embrace it and to choose difficulty because it felt right. And I want to say that when I choose something that feels right, that doesn't mean that it feels good. I wasn't just like so enamored with photography that I didn't feel the strain of money or resources or anything like that. I felt it fully and it hurt and it was difficult. But at the same time, I knew it was right. Sometimes doing the right thing is also the difficult thing, and finding the joy in that process is where people learn to thrive, or they learn to take a backseat to all the difficulties in their life. I think that in so many ways we are all grieving on some level. There's like some level of what we are going through where grief is a part of our journey, and that's at all times, not just when somebody dies or when, you know, part of your life falls apart or something like that. It's very much an everyday experience, and the more we can recognize grief as an everyday experience, the more we can work with that to mold it into something that we are more comfortable with than being constantly at odds with grief. And I say that it's an everyday experience because if we're doing this life, I'm not going to say right, but meaningfully, and growing and becoming someone that we're really proud of continually, then that equally means that we are letting go of a part of who we were continually so that we can become who we're meant to be. And that letting go, that process of continuously every single day letting go of something to make room for something new, is a form of grief. And I think that grief really builds the most and becomes more of a block in our lives when it's building every day, but we don't acknowledge it and we don't take the time to recognize it for what it is. Because grief is something that we so very often don't recognize for what it is. Like I said before, I was going through cycles of grief and I did not know it. And even just the other day, I wrote to my friend Laura and I said, I think I'm depressed. Been going through a hard time with imminently losing my son and not knowing what that will look like or how to cope with that. And she wrote back and she said, I think you're grieving. And she was totally right. There's this aversion to grief, I think, that we have, because surrounding grief is a whole mess of shame, especially in the culture that I live in the United States. There's this real divide between people who are grieving and people who are not. I remember having a conversation with my friend Katie, who lost her mother a few years ago, and she was saying, like, there's this tangible energy between people who have lost somebody close to them and people who have not. And she was saying it's so hard to talk to people who have not lost a parent or somebody in their lives versus how easy it is to talk to people who have. And I was thinking about that because we're not taught how to deal with grief. We're not taught in school or even culturally really what we're supposed to do to process those feelings. And so the fact that grief shows up in our everyday lives surrounding all the decisions that we make and how we move forward into who we're going to be means that we're just ill-equipped to deal with that grief. And it's, I think, the grief of letting go of who you were that stops people from becoming who they're meant to be. And I equate this to art because in art, which I think is one of the highest forms of expression of who we are going to be by creating what we need to move into that space, we are at odds with how we're processing that and how we're dealing with that as a society. So artists are expected to make something of their emotions, of the world, of whatever, and yet we often are not taught how to deal with that process. I have definitely experienced a lot of forms of grief surrounding my art. I did my first photograph and I was super uncomfortable. I made my first film and I was super uncomfortable. I did my first painting just a week or two ago, super uncomfortable. And I think that there is a lot of bravery in that discomfort, and I think that that's what makes someone an artist, is if they can confront that discomfort and find bravery within it. Because if we can choose discomfort, then we can choose to take control of this ship that we are not necessarily steering all the time. That ship being grief and distrust. And I say the word distrust, which maybe is mistrust now that I think about it, because we learn not to trust ourselves. We learn that through these cycles of grief or discomfort or shying away from important decisions, that we are not trustworthy. And what takes control of us is the easy route, the thing that we think is easy, the thing that we think we can trust because it's always going to be there. But the fact is that we are constantly being pushed forward. Constantly. And whether or not we take control over that forward momentum or not is really, I think, what brings out the artistry in us, what brings out the art and the way of living artfully. So we may choose discomfort. We may choose to be uncomfortable in our lives, but that doesn't mean that we are no less entitled to feel every bit of that heartache of what it means to choose discomfort, or in other words, to choose grief. Because choosing grief is choosing bravery. It's choosing to follow that intuition, that curiosity, that sort of way of living for other people. And to do that is one of the most difficult things we can do in our lives. And that's what I did when I chose foster care. I chose to stare at that discomfort in the face. And to say, I know that I will feel you. I know that I will feel grief. But I'm going to do it anyway. Because grief is not something we should be afraid of. It's something that we should embrace and learn about and feel and mold and bring with us so that when it comes again, we're more prepared to deal with it. Just because you choose discomfort doesn't mean that it's uncomfortable, but it means that it will gradually become less uncomfortable. And the more we can get used to that and love that and invite that into our lives, the more that grief and discomfort will become a part of what we do. And I think that those are integral parts of making art, integral parts of being selfless, and really doing something to impact the world. Because if you are just living life as it comes without really seeing how far you can push your impact in the world, then your voice may never contribute to the greater story. And I know that for me, all I want to do is contribute to the greater story, to add something in this world that is meaningful and that touches people and that resonates. And that doesn't mean that it's easy, and that doesn't mean that it's comfortable. And if I have any superpower, it is that I revel in the discomfort. And I find the beauty and the joy there because I recognize and I know so profoundly and deeply that grief is equally a part of joy, and that joy is equally a part of death, and death is equally a part of life, and everything is cyclical. And if we only focus on one side, then we'll never truly understand either. I wanted to share this with you today in the hope that it resonates, and perhaps makes you think about something that you might choose that is difficult, where maybe grief comes to the forefront, but you meet it where it's at, and you bring it with you into the future so that you're better equipped to make those brave, brave decisions. In your art, in your life or elsewhere. Let me know in the comments if you have ever chosen grief or chosen difficulty, knowing that it would bring you that. And what was that experience like for you, and how did you handle it? And I'm asking from a really sincere place, because I'm in a position right now where I'm like right smack in the middle of dealing with that grief and that discomfort and that unknowing, which I think is so exciting and so beautiful and so terrifying. And I would be lying if I said that I was okay, because I'm not right now. I'm going through a lot, and I recognize that I'm not okay, but I also recognize that it's okay to not be okay. And there is something really magical in that, and in that experience, and in studying that experience and letting it be inspirational and not just upsetting. So I'm curious about your stories, and that was just some of mine. I'm sure that I'll share a lot more later once I've processed everything, but thanks for joining me to talk about grief and discomfort, and have a great day, or an uncomfortable one.